Hello friends, welcome to Smart Catalyst. Today we'll be seeing the current affairs of 13 December 2018. The topics we'll be seeing for the day are these nine. First one is about the modern techniques involved in Indian agriculture. Second topic is about the Northeast Special Infrastructure Development Scheme. And third one is about the recently released year-end review of Niti Aayog. The fourth article is about the new reforms introduced in the agricultural sector. Fifth one is about the new technological innovations in the sector of governance by Niti Aayog. Sixth article talks about the National Policy on Biofuels 2018. Seventh one is about bringing in energy efficiency and climate change. Eighth article is about the recent amendment to the Citizenship Bill. And the final article talks about the center's view to boost public health spending 2.5% of GDP. The first article we'll be seeing is Modern Techniques in Agriculture. This article was taken from PIB. In a recently released survey called as Situation Assessment Survey of by National Sample Survey Organization, it was emphasized that 63% of agricultural households in rural area, they depend on agriculture as their principal source of income. However, on the whole, according to Census 2011, about 50% of Indian population still depends on agriculture. So agriculture is considered as backbone of Indian economy as it is still the largest employing sector and it contributes to the human capital formation and plays a very important role in India's national income share. It also ensures food surplus to the expanding population by providing raw materials to the industries as well as contributing to the international trade. So the government to promote modern technologies in the field of agriculture has brought in many schemes in the form of extension reforms, media support to agriculture, Kisan call centers, even agri clinics to provide support to the farmers. And one such scheme launched by the Government of India in 2014 is called as Atma scheme. And this Atma scheme is a centrally sponsored scheme to support state extension programs for extension reforms. So the main objectives of the scheme include to decentralize farmer-driven and farmer-accountable extension system by providing an institutional arrangement using technology. So technology is used as a dissemination tool in the form of Agricultural Technology Management Agency specially created for this purpose. So this Atma will encourage and formulate broad-based extension strategies, thereby helping farmers adopt a group-based approach to extension and also facilitate the convergence of various state-level schemes and foresee the implementation of the scheme in the grassroots district level. The main financial aid for the scheme, it comes from the grant in aids released to the states and the union territories. The second article we'll be seeing is Northeast Special Infrastructure Development Scheme. So this article was also taken from PIB. So the Government of India recently provided 5 crore extension to enable the completion of ongoing projects in the northeastern region. So the projects covered under the scheme include physical infrastructure projects including water supply, power connectivity and projects which promote tourism. So infrastructure project in the field of social sector, especially education and health, will also be given priorities. So the fund for this scheme will be coming from non-lapsable central pool of resources. And this scheme will not only strengthen the human capital via strengthening healthcare and educational facilities, but it will also directly and indirectly create more employment opportunities to the local youth via encouraging tourism sector in the northeastern region. The next article we'll be seeing is the recently released year-end review by Niti Aayog for the year 2018. So Niti Aayog was a think tank which replaced the Planning Commission in the year 2015. And this acts as a unified platform with two basic hubs. One is a Team India hub which mainly focuses on engagement between the center and the state. And second is the Innovation Hub which aims to promote more innovation centers in India. So this Niti Aayog aims to empower the people of India by using an inclusive approach, thereby establishing an egalitarian society. And another important domain of Niti Aayog is to promote cooperative federalism. And in order to measure the performances of different states and rank the states based on the outcome, Niti Aayog has devised various indices. These indices include a special index called as Health Index, which will track the health progress made by the states. And the second one is a composite water management index, which tracks the quality of water and the management of water carried on by different states. And the third index is for education. It's called the School Education Quality Index or SEQI. And Niti Aayog is also the sole designated authority to implement the Sustainable Development Goals in India. And in order to track the progress made by the different states, it has devised Sustainable Development Goal India Index. And Niti Aayog also keeps in to track the digital transformation happening in India. And it measures the digital transformation via Digital Transformation Index. Niti Aayog also releases an index called as State Human Development Report. This is on the lines of National Human Development Report, which is annually released by UNDP. So we are measuring the performances of all the states via the indices. Okay. Niti Aayog helps to establish healthy competition between the states, thus promoting competitive federalism. So there's yet another scheme called as SAT, launched by Niti Aayog. It stands for Sustainable Action for Transforming Human Capital. It mainly focuses on two main sectors, which is education and health. By harnessing the potential in these two important sectors, it aims to harness the demographic dividend in India. Okay, via this scheme, Niti Aayog proposes to identify few role model states which will act as a role model for the other states to implement various schemes. So this scheme is implemented by Niti Aayog in combination with McKinsey and IPE Global Consortium. And another key area of Niti Aayog is to promote inclusive growth. And to promote this inclusive growth in India, Niti Aayog has given fillip to several government initiatives in the name of Sabka Saath and Sabka Vikas. So Niti Aayog recently released special guidelines to Ministry of Panchayat Raj. So in these guidelines, it seeks to promote transparent and equitable distribution of funds, especially among the 6th scheduled states, which includes scheduled tribal area states. The tribal population, they constitute about 8% of India's total population, and including them within the framework of New India becomes very much important for providing inclusive growth. Niti Aayog also plans to restructure the currently functional Rashtriya Gram Swaraj Abhiyan. So this Rashtriya Gram Swaraj Abhiyan is specially designed to address the challenges faced by different states of India. So it mainly aims to develop governance structure with respect to the PRIs in India, in order to achieve the Sustainable Development Goal targets. Niti Aayog also provides technical assistance and capacity building support to the Panchayat Raj institutions in order to achieve the goals. And another group of vulnerable population in India include the disabled people, and they also constitute about 2% of India's population. So currently, the government has National Policy for Persons with Disability, which was brought in the year 2006. However, there are several gaps in the implementation of the policy which needs to be addressed to bring in an inclusive India. Niti Aayog recently released a paper titled Means and Livelihoods of Left-Wing Affected Areas. Bringing in development in left-wing affected areas is very much important to bring in an inclusive India. So in the report, it proposes to utilize the locally available traditional goods to provide employment facilities to the people in the left-wing affected areas. It also created a new portal called as NGO Darpan, which is a dynamic database of providing NGOs a single place platform to apply for grants from all the central ministries. The review report of Niti Aayog also spoke about catalyzing reforms in the domain of agriculture. So Niti Aayog is responsible for implementing the Model Act on Agricultural Land Leasing 2017. So this Land Leasing Act, it aims to protect the rights of the tenants, at the same time also safeguarding the interest of the landowners. By implementing this Model Act on Agricultural Land Leasing, Niti Aayog aims to increase the investment, technology, as well as employment opportunities in agricultural sector in India. The second area is about Agricultural Marketing and Farmer Friendly Reforms Index. So by bringing in Farmer Friendly Reforms Index, it aims to promote healthy competition between different states. It also will sensitize the states about the reforms needed in main sectors of agricultural marketing, including land leasing and forestry in private land. The third area in this is Pradhan Mantri Krishi Sinchai Yojana. According to Economic Survey 2017, the area under irrigation in India stands at around 34.5% of total area. With the increasing influence of climate change and lack of availability of water, increasing this area under irrigation becomes very much important to protect the livelihood of farmers. The next area is about price deficiency payment. So price deficiency payment is seen by Niti Aayog as an alternative to the physical procurement via the MSP. This project is also implemented as mission mode project in the state of Madhya Pradesh in order to check its viability. The Niti Aayog's report also talks about rejuvenating the fertilizer sector and making India a self-sufficient fertilizer producer by the year of 2020. And special task force is also set up on piloting business model for doubling farmers' income by using a market-driven approach in order to minimize the risks faced by Indian farmers. The report of Niti Aayog also talks about the adoption of frontier technologies in order to improve the governance in India. And the first area is about artificial intelligence. So Niti Aayog has been mandated to come up with national program on artificial intelligence. So this national program on artificial intelligence, it plans to assess the impact of artificial intelligence in Indian economy. And it will also study artificial intelligence and its positive impacts in bringing in social change and improve the governance in India. In order to develop this national program on artificial intelligence, Niti Aayog seeks technology support to IBM as well as ISRO, and it has even come up with a pilot project to support the application of artificial intelligence to develop the crop yield prediction. By linking artificial intelligence to the crop yield production, the farmers will be able to get real-time advisory data on the crop yield. And this project is already being implemented in a few of the aspirational districts program, which is also under the implementation of Niti Aayog. In this area, Niti Aayog has already come up with a strategy on artificial intelligence. So this recently released strategy, it details the core areas and even provides recommendations on the use of artificial intelligence in order to increase and promote good governance in India. Niti Aayog is also mandated to look into the blockchain technology. So here, Niti Aayog will seek to provide conceptual framework and architectural design of India chain, thereby enhancing the security of data transfer in India. The second area for technological innovation in governance is implementing a methanol economy. So this methanol economy is mainly devised to reduce the dependency on the fossil fuels, thereby minimizing India's imports of fossil fuels from other countries. So in order to promote this, Niti Aayog has even come up with initiatives for production of methanol from areas like high ash coal as well as municipal solid waste. So the Ministry of Shipping has even decided to use methanol blended fuel for inland waterway transportation, thereby reducing the dependence on fossil fuels. The Government of India also proposes to set up a new fund called as Methanol Economy Fund, which will help promote indigenously produced methanol as alternative to currently used fossil fuels. So in this area, the Government of India has even come up with national policy on biofuels. In the year 2018, in order to minimize the dependence on fossil fuels as well as providing farmers a income support. So this national policy on biofuels 2018, it provides an indicative target of blending 20% of ethanol with petrol and even 5% of biodiesel with diesel by 2030. So it has categorized the biofuels into three categories. First generation biofuels, which comes from edible crops. Second generation biofuels coming from non-edible crops. And third generation of biofuels coming from microorganism like algae. There's even another classification of biofuel recently devised called as fourth generation biofuel, which is made from genetically engineered organisms specially for this purpose. This policy also provides viability gap funding for promoting second generation ethanol biofuels. And it also provides tax incentives and price support for first generation biofuels as well. It even proposes to set up a special committee called as Biofuel Coordination Committee under the domain of Ministry of Petroleum and Natural Gas on study the working of the biofuels. And sufficient trust is also given on research and development of biofuels in India. So what are the expected benefits out of this biofuels? So currently, India depends on import of fossil fuels to support 80% of its fuel needs. So bringing in this biofuel policy will definitely reduce the import dependency of India. Second one is biofuel is definitely a cleaner form of fuel, and it will thus help in creating a cleaner environment, acting as a mitigation to the climate change. So as it prevents climate change, it will definitely have health benefits. So the recently released Lancet report, it states that almost 25% of total global deaths from the climate change occurs only in India, And by bringing in national policy on biofuel is a right step in this direction. This policy will also increase the efficiency of sewage management in urban areas and also increase the infrastructural investment in rural areas as well. The employment generation in the rural areas will be increased, and it will also act as an important source of additional income to the farmers. The next article we'll be seeing is Energy Efficiency and Climate Change. This article was taken from the newspaper Mint. So recently, Lancet has released a climate change report. And according to that report, more than 70% of India's population is exposed to outdoor air pollution, and almost 23% of the global deaths coming from air pollution, it occurs only in India. And this air pollution also contributes to 1 out of every 8 deaths occurring in India. And average life expectancy of average Indian also comes down by nearly 2 years because of air pollution. So this report shows that extreme weather conditions like air pollution, crop failure, biodiversity losses not just affect the natural wealth of Indian economy, but also has a very big toll on human health of individuals. One important way to curtail this air pollution is bringing the global carbon emissions and the greenhouse emissions down. And the important strategy to do this is via carbon pricing. So this carbon pricing has attracted more attention in the recent years. So this carbon pricing, it works on the mechanism of negative externality. As it puts a price on excessive carbon emission and thus curtails the pollution. However, this carbon pricing reforms are not enough to curtail the temperature by 2 degrees Celsius of pre-industrial level as mandated by IPCC. So this calls for serious reforms in other areas too. One such area which needs to be reformed is bringing in energy efficiency. So industries are one of the major sources of carbon dioxide emissions in India. And the recent trend shows that larger industrial enterprises shifting from urban areas to rural areas. And empirical statistics also shows that the industries in the rural areas, they release more carbon dioxide when compared to the same ones in urban areas. So this shows that spatial disparities is one of the major area of concern in providing energy security. So India is undergoing a demographic of shift from aging population to younger generation. So this shift demands for less polluted kitchens, more usage of electric vehicles, as well as energy efficient technologies. So all these three areas has huge potential to increase the energy efficiency, thereby curtailing the climate change. So bringing in energy efficiency requires investment, and this investment can be bought in via financial instruments like green mortgaging, green bonds, and offering tax incentives to the enterprises in the renewable energy sector. So these initiatives can be clubbed with functioning public-private partnership in the energy sector, which will act as a big boost to scale energy efficiency in our country. The next article we'll be seeing is Getting Citizenship Could Become Easier for Some. So this article was taken from the newspaper Hindu. So the government has been pushing for the passage of Citizenship Amendment Bill 2016. So what is the important provision of this bill? So this bill, it aims to provide citizenship status to specific refugees on the religious ground. So these refugees include Hindus, Sikhs, Buddhists, Jains, Parsis and the Christians from the countries of Afghanistan, Bangladesh and Pakistan. So this bill mandates them not to be treated as illegal immigrants, even if they have entered Indian boundaries without any valid documents. So this bill also seeks to bring in changes to the provision of naturalization. Earlier, the period for gaining citizenship via the provision of naturalization was 12 years, and this amendment, it seeks to reduce it by the period of 7 years. And the bill also claims to bring in stringent punishment for the OCI holders in case of violation of the Citizenship Act or any other laws in our country. So the government is empowered to cancel the registration of the overseas citizens of India upon such violation. So what is the area of contention here? So as we all know, Article 14 of Indian Constitution provides right to equality to both Indian citizens as well as to foreigners. So however, the recently proposed amendments, it is against the principle of equality as it distinguishes illegal immigrants on the basis of religion. So there is also strong opposition against the implementation of this bill in the state of Assam. This bill also faces stiff opposition in northeastern states, especially Assam. The state of Assam already faces the problem of illegal immigration, And Assam National Registry of Citizens is already implemented in order to end this problem. The people of Assam fear that the implementation of bill will further increase the illegal immigration into their state, thereby causing serious demographic rift in the state of Assam. The final article for the day is, Center seeks to boost public health spending to 2.5% of GDP by 2025. This article was also taken from the paper Mint. So in the proposed National Health Policy of 2017, the government seeks to increase the public health spending. So the spending will go up from current 1.15% to 2.5% by the year 2025 in a phased manner. So there is also a main shift from the sick care to the wellness perspective. And the wellness will not just focus on disease care, but also palliative care, mental health, old age problems, rehabilitative healthcare services, as well as non-communicable diseases. Vulnerable sections such as women, children, as well as youth will continue to be the main target groups of this national health initiative. And this initiative will also offer free drugs, emergency services, as well as free diagnostic services to every citizen. By offering these, it aims to reduce the out-of-pocket expenditure, which is very, very high in India. So the government has come up with Ayushman Bharat scheme. This scheme provides a comprehensive framework to provide health care, not just in primary sector, but also primary, secondary, as well as tertiary healthcare services. It also aims to promote healthy lifestyle among Indians by using yoga and through health and wellness centers. It also seeks to integrate Make in India initiatives to manufacture local drugs and also utilizes the services of indigenous medical system of Ayush. It also provides ambitious targets to reduce the incidence of HIV/AIDS by 2020, bring down infant mortality to 28 by 2019, and also to reduce premature mortality from non-communicable diseases by at least 20% by 2025, which will all lead to increase in life expectancy by 2025 from current 67.5 years to 70 years. In this area, India recently hosted Partners Forum 2018 in New Delhi. So this was hosted in partnership with Ministry of Health and Family Welfare and Partnership of Maternal, Newborn and Child Health. And this platform is a track to diplomacy platform, which was formed in the year 2005, aimed to accelerate efforts to reduce the child mortality and maternal mortality. It also focuses to improve the health of adolescent child as well as newborns. And this forum was organized in India for the second time, and the first one being organized in the year 2010.